sarsaparilla, what I found out about sarsaparilla is interesting. It cures leprosy.
Really? Cures it?
Apparently, that's what I read.
Right, so I'm really excited because we're here with Kenny. Hi, Kenny.
Hello.
Thanks, so good to see you.
Welcome.
We're in Glastonbury at the Excalibur Jun Creation Plant Headquarters. Quick look at this. So, this is one of Kenny's many amazing creations. Mate, what have you created?
Well, you know, kombucha, as you know, is quite a popular beverage these days, and I know the US market's, you know, 600 million plus per year now. And, you know, I got into fermentation some time ago when I lived in California because a friend of mine, his name was Cosmic Pepper Man.
That's a good name.
Yeah, he used to work at Nature's First Law back in the day. And he showed me how to make sauerkraut. I got into this milk kefir stuff, which I was talking about earlier.
Yeah.
And it had a tremendous effect on my health. I'd been away traveling and I was, you know, having some health issues due to being in a third world country. And it really brought me back to life. I was amazed. And it got me really excited about fermented foods. I'd been doing some studying and looked at all the kind of blogs and all the literature out there regarding the topic. So I got really excited because a lot of what was in the literature was corroborated by my experience previously.
Okay.
Which is quite interesting. So it took me on this journey of making all these different kinds of fermented food, and one of them was jun. I was a bit concerned about the sugar content in some of the kombuchas out there. So I thought, oh, wow, I wonder if we could do it a bit differently. And I came across jun on the internet. And at the time, I was studying chaga mushroom, actually, and I was looking at that and getting really excited. And I thought, well, we know how to do an alcohol extraction. We know how to do a water extraction, which is what most people are doing. But how do you ferment it?
Ooh, okay.
So initially, I was using it in cultured vegetables, but it was a bit of a bizarre kind of...
So with that, what you did is you fermented the vegetables and put the chaga in there?
Yeah, the powder.
Okay, yeah.
And it was a bit...
Yeah.
You could tell it was doing something. You could tell it was extracting something, but it was a bit woody. It wasn't really...
Yeah.
Sauerkraut. So I was looking on the internet and I found actually a David Wolf webinar on chaga, and he talked about you can ferment it with a jun culture, and I was like, wow,
perfect.
So I got online, ordered a culture, and then started making it. I had some really good honey at the time, and voila, here it is.
So what we've got is we've got jun, which is similar to kombucha, but what you're saying is you feed it honey.
Yeah, I mean, basically the difference is the substrate, which is the food that you give the culture. It's with kombucha, traditionally, it's black tea and sugar.
Okay.
Most people are just using white sugar, whether it's organic or not, I don't know. But I was a bit concerned about that and the fact that it's been touted as a health beverage. I'm sure it's got some redeeming qualities, but, you know, you don't often hear the whole story. So I was like, I'm into honey, I like honey. And so I was really excited about the fact that jun eats honey. So I started experimenting, and we came up with all these flavours. Chaga's the one you like.
I love it, yeah.
But we've got like an Amazonia, which is Amazonian herb. We've got a ginkgo one. We've got sarsaparilla. We've got hibiscus. We've even got kombucha now, which is like a low sugar one.
Okay.
That we're doing.
So you just don't feed it as much, or?
Well, I just ferment all the sugar out.
Ah, okay, ferment it more.
And then I add a little bit of that liquid stevia.
Yeah.
That's sweet.
Okay. So we're going to taste it, finally.
Okay, so this one, I'll try this one first.
What's this? Hibiscus. Okay. Okay, so otherwise, if you leave it unrefrigerated, it keeps fermenting.
Yeah. Okay. And then it gets, you know, you can go alcoholic and...
What's the shelf life, do you think, on a bottle? Once, like, as soon as it's bottled, how long will they last?
Well, it won't go off.
No, just keep...
But it'll go alcoholic.
Right.
And then it'll, let's let that head go down. First of all, it'll go alcoholic, and then it'll go to vinegar. So yeah, it requires refrigeration. If you want it to taste like this.
Yeah. So would you say if someone opened a kombucha or a jun and it tasted vinegary, would you say that's gone, I mean, that's obviously further down the process, it's gone too far, or?
If people wanted to drink kombucha, I would say you're better off drinking it as a vinegar, to be honest.
Huh. All right.
Because you're not dealing with sugar then.
Because the sugar's been fermented out.
So that's really that's optimal for kombucha, I think.
Yeah.
If you want to be safe.
All right. Let's do it. And what about it, Tomar?
Tea.
Okay.
All right, so.
Salud.
Salud.
Cheers.
So that
that's lovely.
Cold,
amazing.
And fizzy kind of bite is where you want it.
Yeah.
This is kind of like fruity, isn't it? It's almost like a raspberry like flavour.
Mm. It's definitely fruity,
yeah.
Yeah.
Compared to the chaga.
Yeah.
It's a bit different.
The chaga I kind of find is quite kind of one of my personal things. Kind of smoky, musty, but also because of the honey or something, but sweet.
Yeah.
But this is, yeah, this is like sweet, fizzy. I guess when I think about it, it's kind of like a really healthy soda or fizzy pop, isn't
yeah.
it?
Yeah.
Yeah,
that's the kind of... I mean, traditionally, we would, you know, all of our drinks would have been like this.
Yeah.
Because a lot, there were a lot of sanitation issues,
mm.
you know, 100, 200 years ago.
Yeah.
In North America and the UK. So traditionally, people would brew drinks like this, which would be called beers, just to be safe.
To kill off, to clean out anything else that was in there. Huh. So, let's have a look at it.
Sure, so we've got a barrel here. This is the chaga gin. I'm not producing massive amounts of gin right now because we've got loads in the fridge. We're focusing more on kimchi, which I'll show you in a minute.
Right.
This is a barrel of...
Look, it's wood!
Chaga gin. These are chestnut barrels, and actually we bought them brand new, so we've still got some of the tannins coming out of the barrel, which traditionally in wine do affect flavour.
So can it, like, does the fermentation process, I mean, that's more aggressive than just having water in a plastic thing, right?
Far more.
Right.
Because you're dealing with weak organic acids like acetic acid and lactic acid, which will, you know, I don't know if you've observed these things when they come into contact with metal or anything like that, but they're very corrosive. So I wouldn't put any kind of fermented product in plastic. I definitely wouldn't ferment it in plastic.
Mm.
The demand became much more vigorous, so we had to go to a bigger...
Yeah, to get these
I don't
beasts.
Think we're
going to
go any bigger than this, actually.
It's beautiful. You think it can hear me?
It could, perhaps. So, this is... I'll take this off here. You can smell it. It's
It smells delicious.
This is ready for bottle tomorrow.
Wow. Oh, it looks horrendous.
Yeah. it looks like internal organs, which is a bit of a
that's
bit of a clue, isn't it?
Mm.
It's a bit of a clue.
Tell me exactly what has happened to this thing.
So what we've done is
you started with an empty barrel.
I start with an empty barrel, sanitised, obviously.
Mm.
So we start with an empty barrel and we fill it up with tea.
Okay.
This one is chaga tea, and then green tea and yerba mate, which are made separately because we don't want to put the grounds in together because you want to reboil the chaga and get all the stuff out of it.
Yeah.
We make the tea and then we add in the honey.
Yeah.
Once it's cooled down somewhat.
Okay.
So we put in the raw honey.
Yeah.
Depending on whether it's solid honey or it's liquid, depending on the time of the year.
Yeah.
We'll either put the pourable liquid honey in and dissolve it, or we'll, if it's hard, we'll chop it up into little pieces and put it in one of those big Vitamixes in there.
Yeah,
with the 5 litre.
Oh no, 5 litres.
Yeah, there's a big, huge jug that you get with Monster. So we use one of those to blend the honey up.
Yeah.
And then we sweeten it, and then we let it cool down completely. Now with barrels, they're quite, they do keep the heat in, so sometimes you have to add in some gin vinegar.
Okay.
To get the pH down so nothing can grow in it.
Yeah.
Just to make sure, that's a health and safety thing. And then sometimes we'll leave it overnight, come in early in the morning, and then we'll put the culture in.
Okay.
And then we cover it, and then we leave it for between, depending on the time of the year, between 8 to 10 days.
Okay.
Until we get that...
8 to 10 days?
Yeah, something like that. Until we get that real good combination of sweet and tart.
Mm.
I'm just going to cover this and destroy now.
That's it. Have a nice time. See you sometime soon.
Okay. This is just tannins, actually. It's not good.
So you said it kind of looks like internal organs.
Yeah.
Go on.
Well, you know, when I first got into fermentation, I had some pretty mystical experiences, actually.
Mm.
I mean, I talk about this, but I don't know how whether people are really getting what I'm saying. But when I started working with the kefir culture, for example, I started getting all this information.
Right.
In my while I was sleeping.
Okay.
It's like it was going all this downloads of information. And
you remembered it from your dreams.
I got the information. I was like, wow, that's bizarre.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, I was actually awake, but at night, you know, I was getting all this information, you know, when everything slows down,
yeah,
and just working with it, and subsequently working with all the herbs. I don't know if you're aware of the concept of plant spirit shamanism.
Absolutely,
or,
yeah.
You know, plants actually do tell me what to do.
Yeah.
And what I discovered was that it's also the same with these life forms, these microorganisms, our consciousness in the same way. And in some ways, they speak more loudly than the subtle messages you get from plants, because it's a symbiotic culture, if you will.
Mm.
So there's many different consciousnesses working together. This is just my experience.
All right, cool, let's do another taste. I want to try some of these
other
ones.
This is sarsaparilla. What I was trying to do with this was create what's called traditionally a root beer.
Ah.
And so I've got the recipe. This one's got sarsaparilla, birch bark, sassafras, is used for some other things.
Mm.
Rhodiola rosea, Romania, yerba mate, hawthorn leaf, and then all the water and the honey and stuff like that. Right, so this is sarsaparilla.
Here we go. Cheers to you ahora. Cierto que es. Salud.
Cheers, thank you.
Love that.
Oh, it's so good. It's that's really different.
It's different to the chaga, right?
I don't even know what to say. Hang on.
Mm.
¿Te gusta?
Mucho. There's a flavor I cannot
describe.
Yeah, there's
like a...
Tulsi?
It's kind of in the... It could be the... It's a tulsi.
Tulsi,
it's a
right? No?
Oh, is it not? It really is.
But it does taste like it.
There's something.
I have made a tulsi one, which I haven't
right.
actually brought out commercially, and it's delicious,
yeah.
Actually. Tulsi, passion flower. And rooibos chai. That's amazing.
Yeah.
That's amazing flavour. I'm going to bring that out. We're just dealing with getting these ones out now, but
yeah.
That is, once it's kind of gone full circle with the secondary fermentation,
yeah.
Tastes like a really, really delicious version of Coca-Cola. With the tulsi.
Yeah. So just reading here, why have you chosen yerba mate to put in there as well for the tea?
Yerba mate is in all of the flavours.
Yeah.
I had a spiritual experience on yerba mate once.
Okay.
On a dance floor.
Okay.
I was at this club and I didn't want to take any ecstasy or anything like that.
No.
Because I'd been fasting, actually. So I thought, oh, I'll drink a little yerba mate. So I drank like 4 or 5 cups.
Oh,
wow. They were playing
drum
and bass. That drum and bass. I went nuts. And I had all these downloads. This was years ago when I first moved to America. And,
yeah.
So that was kind of one of the reasonings behind that. And then
okay.
I've since found out that it's really good for your neurological health. It's called a nootropic.
Yeah, okay.
So, but it was, the reason why is because I've just got guided to put it in.
Yeah, just felt right.
There's nothing other than, the reason why any of these ingredients are in here is because that's the message about.
Like, if you'd asked me before I did the Vipassana meditation, that kind of question, and having this kind of conversation, I would have been less able to appreciate it. But I don't know if you've done Vipassana when you sit for 10 days in silence. Like, some of the physical experiences I had from doing nothing, just doing the meditation, I was like, oh yeah, cool. There's way more possible now.
Yeah, well, you know, everything slows down and, you know, you start to kind of move out all of the distractions and
yeah.
all the stuff that's there all the time, you can begin to hear, you know.
Yeah. All right, so let's have a look at this. This is a salsa. It's
this
like
a
fermented...
Yeah, it's a fermented salsa. This was the first kind of cultured vegetable that I actually put out as a product.
Mm.
I'm going to open one here that hasn't got a label on it.
Okay.
We've got 5 flavours. We've got kimchi. We've got various different cabbage ones. But I like this one the most. Mm.
Thank you very much.
It's got a strong...
That has a strong smell.
Very spicy.
So what's in it? What's...
This has got tomatoes, onions, garlic... chili, lemon, oregano,
ooh. Mm. It's got a little taste of the oregano.
Oregano.
That is strong, isn't it?
Coriander as well. Huh. Cilantro as some people want. I just found the recipe and I just made it. I thought it was delicious. I thought, wow, you can sell this.
Yeah.
And that's actually how it started, with this and the chaga gin.
Yeah.
That's the first one we did.
Yeah.
And it just took off. It's different from the traditional salsa.
Yeah. You're on it, mate. You're on a really good mission. And it's really tasty as well.
It's exciting, isn't it? You know, I've tasted all this other stuff in the UK marketplace. It doesn't taste as good. I'm not blowing my own trumpet here. This is...
It is tasty. It's really, really tasty.
I could be biased, but I've tasted the sauerkrauts and the kombuchas, and they're okay.
Mate, thank you for having us here.
You're welcome.
Thank you for giving us the tour, and this is beautiful.
Thanks for coming.
Yeah, good.
Really appreciate it.
Mate, well, I'm going to keep drinking this stuff, and
yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.